the Bass Rock with the Marr family, Fred, Chris, and Pat.
Sunday the 21st of May 2000 was a great day for Sula II, a pleasure boat operating out of North Berwick. The guest of honour, or the passenger of honour, was Prince Charles. He was doing what so many other passengers have done over the last 40 years. He was going out on Sula II to see the Bass Rock, the wonderful island that is home to thousands and thousands of gannets. The name Sula II is linked inextricably to another name, Fred Marr. Fred's family, the Marrs, has lived in the seaside town of North Berwick for 14 generations. In his younger days, Fred was skipper in several of the pleasure boats that took people round the islands. And in 1970, he got the opportunity of buying his own pleasure boat, which he called Sula. After only just 1 year, he upgraded to a bigger, better boat, the Sula II. Fred Marr died in 2008. Chris, his son, who worked for many years alongside his father, has taken over. Pat, Fred's daughter, now Mrs. McCauley, has also been working on Sula II for over 20 years. Let's join the Sula II for one of its trips to the Bass Rock. Passengers are waiting till it's time to go.
Okay, my name's Adrian Coppola. As a kid, we used to holiday down here with my grandparents for 2 weeks in the summer. And we're back now on a trip of nostalgia with my three kids. This is the first time I've been back on the boat since I was probably 6 or 7 years old. So it's the last chance that they'll get now that they're finishing up this year.
What I'm going to do now is just pass around some of these folders. This one in particular is talking about the gannet rescue work that we do. Dad started all those years ago. And these other two albums here are talking about, are photographs mainly of Chris's talk. So it's the history of the coastline.
Gannets.
Wow.
Which I wish I could say I'd taken myself. But I
sometimes these photographs are of people that have landed on the Bass Rock over the years and they've sent us photographs.
So my job is a mixed bundle of looking after the healthy birds, hopefully, and then just feeding them and releasing them.
This is me putting my anti-wrinkle cream on for your
evening. Walk of historical interest in the opposite shore here. When the fortress in the Bass was garrisoned, that small hamlet opposite there called Canty B, that was the port for the Bass. And Talon Castle itself, stronghold of the Red Douglases. Further east still, down a sea cliff beach, that long sloping red rock close to the cliff there called the Gideon, which is buoy and saved the 5-man crew, and shortly after that she started to break up. And by then the locals would have known what she was carrying. She had 110 liquid tons of brandy in the hold.
Okay. Hi, my name is Lorenzo. I'm originally from Italy, but I live in Edinburgh, and I'm looking forward to getting nearer to the rock. The camera is a Canon EOS 1. It's film. I still shoot film, one of the few left. No digital backing, as you can see. And hopefully I'll get some good shots.
The 39 men imprisoned on here over that period were mainly leading Protestant ministers. Possibly the best known of them was John Blackadder. He was imprisoned on the rock and died here after 5 years imprisonment. See his tombstone in the old Kirkport Cemetery in North Berwick, a big flat one and six legs in the middle.
On the Bass Rock, the cliffs are mostly a sheer drop to the sea, so most nests, the gannets' nests in particular, are on top of the rock, like these. I wonder if the gannets appreciate the view back to North Berwick and its little hill called the Law. For now, our trip on Sula II goes clockwise round the Bass. And looking back from the north, the rock face, in shadow, looks very dark, there, beside it, but much further away, is the Law again. Both the Bass and the Law are extinct volcanoes. Rather a nice pair they make, seen side by side.
My father used to say, off to get nappies on the birds. Somehow I don't think that's going to work either.
Further round, the cliffs are still very sheer. In medieval days, there was a cannon on the top to repel any attackers, and that was replaced by a foghorn. The foghorn is still visible, but no longer in use. And further round still, we come to where there are caves in the side of the rock. Investigating these by kayak must be quite fun. It is here, near the caves and near the lighthouse, that birds find places to perch or make their nests lower down.
There's that gannet there, sky pointing, the one at the extreme left hand end there, to leave the nesting site. It looks as if he points it out, they don't do that, but that's what it indicates to his mate. Sky pointing again, he's starting to turn round. The fact that the boat's here, he may not take off, but again, that's an indication of what it's about to do. Now, if you look at the gannet's head, you'll see the eyes are set at the front. That's binocular vision. It gives the bird an accurate focus while it's in the air. It gains the depth of the fish and the height it needs to get down to them. That cushions the shock of the dive. Jacobite supporters held the rock against the rule of William of Orange for the exiled Stuart, James II, 37th of Scotland. Now, this is more a protest than anything else. But having said that, there's very little the government can do to get the men off, short of starving them out. Now, the second scene puts perhaps a more interesting opportunity. On that occasion, four young Jacobite officers captured a skirmish in the Highlands at Sunvale, in Britain's on the rock here. They took their chance and overpowered the remaining guards. Now, the rock was weakly manned at the time, and all available men were down and loading their coal boats bound round at the lower part here. Having locked the upper gate, they turned the guns in the garrison and forced them to leave. A dozen supporters joined them from the mainland, and they went to sympathies with the Jacobite cause. James was in exile at the French court, and the French kept them supplied with food for a time, until an effective blockade stopped the men leaving the rock and the supplies getting through to them. Now, the story goes, we gained our freedom by a ruse. They remained their freedom on their own terms. Now that was the last time the rock was used as a prison. The fact that being a thorn in the government's side was shot for it. There was a proviso, however, that the government should be fortified the rock if they thought necessary, and it never was. You will find youngsters here September and even October. Now they only come ashore to breed once that's finished and migrate south. Down the channel of the Bay of Biscay, down the Med, and even as far as the equator of the Arctic coast. This year youngsters tend to stay away until they're in their third year before they start to come back.
With so many hazards to cope with, it's no surprise that baby gannets get separated from their parents and die. So rescuing abandoned chicks, taking them back home, feeding them, and later releasing them has become one of the Marr family traditions. We're on our way home. Pat is getting ready to collect the fares. Adults are £12 each. Children are £6.
Thank you very much. Thanks now. We'll have a visitor's book there if you wish to sign it, okay? See, the crew get wet as well. Sorry?
Never did anybody.
No. We won't charge you any extra for excitement.
Yeah. That's part of the fun.
How is it for two or one? Two and two is £36, please. Thank you. We're sitting. Thank you very much.
In the middle area there. Lovely. Spray comes down the sides if you don't want it. Oh. Yes.
Before returning to harbour, Sula II goes round Craigleith Island.
These big stacks of
There are no gannets on Craig Lough. Usually there are puffins, though perhaps today we might not see any. As Pat explains, vegetation called mallow has been blocking the puffins' burrows, though recently volunteers have cleared a lot of that away. There's a pile of the great thick mallow roots or stems that are blocking the puffins' burrows. It's now time to come home. And Sula II heads for the harbour. It's been a lovely trip. Thank you, Marr, all of you. Especially Chris and Pat.